Okay, so bad, bad, not good. How are you doing?
Great, good.
All right. How would you describe your experience at Montreux so far?
It's been short so far, but it's been really good catering.
Okay, the food was amazing.
That's
basically, we just got here.
So, food, lots of amazing pictures and amazing performances. And I've also heard so much about the festival and seen so many DVDs and live performances.
Montreux is crazy.
It was really great to be here. And we're very
the place is beautiful as well, Montreux.
Yeah, the most beautiful place ever.
Mm-hmm.
It's steeped in history in terms of jazz and music. How do you feel about coming here? Because it's quite an honor to be playing in the jazz club.
It's literally an honor. Especially opening for Charles Bradley, like another hero of ours.
Excellent. And I'm just going to ask you a little bit about your beginnings. Obviously, you've probably heard these cliche questions, but how did the band start?
Just like we all met in, like, basically we were like in jazz school, like studying like applied jazz.
It's like jazz camp,
or is that? In university.
Kind of, it was like a degree.
It was a very intense degree. We all hated it. And then we dropped out. Formed the band.
Excellent. We informally formed the band. Yeah.
And then it started to work out, and you know, we got some attention with all the things we were doing, and then things led to just kind of a decision to just, you know, pursue this opportunity and try to make something of it, and so far it's been going all right.
Excellent. So, and was there, were there other previous members, or just?
No, nope. Always with the three of us.
Just a trio, yes.
Founding.
We kicked out of trombone player.
Okay, moving on. We're just okay. So, talking about Toronto, what's it like to be raised there, to live there? What's the scene like, the hip hop jazz scene? And is there a hip hop jazz scene in Toronto?
Funny enough, none of us are actually born and raised there.
Okay, fair enough.
Chester's from Ottawa, me and Matt are actually from Mississauga.
I was actually born in Montreal as well.
I moved to Toronto between high school, so like going into grade 11. So I've lived there now for like, I guess like 8 years or so.
We've all lived in Toronto for probably four. I've lived there for 4 years.
Yeah, I've lived there for 2 years. Yeah, for like eight or so. So I guess what I'm trying to say is at the right time of our lives, we've lived there.
Yeah.
The time where you actually go explore and you find out like, who's doing cool shit and what cool spots to check out music and
so what sort of like shows and what stuff. Sort of music and what sort of like cool stuff did you engage with or find interesting in Toronto? Can you name some bands or something that will coming up or that you're interested in?
Yeah, there's like a lot of cool bands from Toronto. I mean, yeah, just like seeing like it's a cool like major city.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So just like the fact you can like see a show, especially when you live there, like see a show, like I saw like 200 shows in like 1 year almost, just because it was going to shows like all made out when you're like 2 years. Yeah. But yeah, it's like seeing shows like non-stop.
Do you have a favorite venue or something that you've gone to before?
I mean, all the venues.
There's a lot of awesome ones.
But they all kind of like, it's always like a band will play like, you know, the Phoenix, and they'll play like Wrong Bar, but it doesn't make sense because it's like for some reason whoever books it is just like, what's a venue in Toronto?
There's a lot of great venues. It all really just depends on
like who's
what
playing
you're going
there.
To see or yeah. what. Yeah, who's playing? We're going to see. I mean, there's like a lot of great venues that just do like open mic nights that are super
yeah.
cool.
Cool. Okay. And that's something you're more into, the more sort of lucid, sort of freer, sort of live stuff, or are you more interested in?
I think it just depends on who we're hanging out with, who wants to check out what we're doing, how much money they have to buy tickets.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of like what the night is entailing. So there's always so much cool stuff to check out.
Awesome. And you've been described as a kind of like fusion between different genres and that sort of stuff. And do genres scare you? Are you scared of genres? Are you scared of that sort of labeling?
I wouldn't say we're scared.
No, I'm scared.
We don't really care.
I just don't really know what the make of some of them, I guess, in terms of like even, you know, what influences or like what we listen to. Because there's so much music, it doesn't make sense to just like, we always describe it, our music as like some kind of jazz, hip hop. Speaking of influences,
what influence screamed at you to follow your dreams and not do the 9-to-5?
I think
musicians and what kind of musician?
It was basically just like when we were all like, oh, what university should we go to? Because we should probably go to university. Like, what do we want to do? Definitely not playing boring, you know what
yeah.
I mean? Obviously not looking at like, oh, like I hope I have a career in this someday, which is like not likely the case.
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, I don't know, just like that basically, just like, you know, wanting to go to school for something, to learn something more, but not really.
Because your school was jazz, so there must be some sort of jazz or some jazz musicians that grabbed you from that, or influenced you in that way.
I'd say like when we all sort of got more, like, you reach
yeah,
a point.
Why don't you say like why you went to that school? Yeah. It's all going to be totally different. We didn't know
well,
each other.
Like,
well,
I was just
going to
say, like, I'd say we all got into playing jazz in general because it's a natural step when you're like getting better at an instrument, kind of. Like, you can get really serious about music. Usually, it's like jazz or classical, or like
in terms of education.
Whatever,
it's not only like a genre; it's like a whole like approach and practice.
Yeah,
like
right.
Performance practice.
The educational system is basically
like learning
jazz
music
and classical, and you know,
two different directions.
You can take
right.
like rock and drum lessons at like a corner store, or, like five
minutes. But if you want to actually learn how to play the drums properly, you can
yeah.
the jazz.
Well, not even. It's more just kind of like if you want to pursue it in a school setting or educational. Yeah,
okay.
A degree of some kind. It's like you either gotta go to classical or you gotta go into some kind of jazz program of some kind.
Now, there's obviously been artists such as Miles Davis played here, and are they sort of people that you would listen to or you found influential? Or
100%.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I mean,
Miles
Davis
probably like...
I don't think we'll ever be on that level whatsoever.
No.
Because Miles Davis is like one of the fucking...
But yeah, definitely listen to all that.
I mean, like...
Stuff.
Yeah, Miles Davis' like, entire career
yeah.
is like incredible, you know what I mean? Like, just like the amount of like different people he basically like, put on and then they became famous and then like... You know, I don't know, it's just, like, insane. You know, to think about, like, Tony Williams and some of his records, like, 16, you know, it's, like, it's crazy.
He's always pursued evolving.
Yeah, and
sound,
like,
pushing boundaries, fucking, you know, just being...
Especially for, like, you know, like, the mid-60s onwards. And, like, everything he did, like, you know, a lot of people liked it, but there's also, like, a lot of people who didn't like it,
yeah.
but that was cool, too.
Okay,
you know
cool,
I mean? Like,
exactly, because that's what it's about,
yeah.
isn't it? It's like you're making it for yourselves or for the people who love the music in general, and... have you been surprised by your critical reception, which is pretty positive for my...
Definitely,
yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah.
We're very grateful that people are enjoying what we're doing and receiving it in a positive manner, because we're just, you know, we took a risk and just started doing it, and now
that
we're pursuing it more, we kind of, you know, adapted our own style of playing live and that kind of stuff, so, and people seem to enjoy it. We're just very happy and grateful that it's turning out that way, because it's not the same way for a lot of people, so...
That's awesome.
We're very fortunate.
Mm-hmm. Have you, now, I heard that you were into MF Doom.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you reached out to MF Doom about anything, or...
Yeah, you're probably in Badbadnotgood, right?
You can do it by now, surely. Knocking his door.
Why don't I just like capture this? Why don't I just say one sentence? We've met Lex Records, which is the label that he's on now, and they're amazing people and they do really cool projects. And we actually hung out with them last week when we were in London. And,
excellent.
We all have fun hanging out.
We've been in touch.
In touch with Doom in a way. Yeah.
Well, that's the kind of
which
exclusive.
Is also like kind of mind blowing because we've all been listening to
Doom
since we were grade 9 and
crazy.
And another person you've obviously worked with as well, Tyler the Creator. Are you tired of talking about Tyler the Creator yet?
I don't know. It's like a great
That's actually a good question.
Usually
everyone's
just
like, "What's he like?"
So, I mean, like Google like our name and like what questions can I ask like the night before or whatever. And
yeah.
It's like, what was it like with Tyler? It's like, yeah, it's always like he misses all the time. It's like.
I guess we're probably tired of talking about working with him.
He's the reason why we're doing this. Like,
so you would say you're half tired of talking about him, but you're happy that he connected with you.
100%.
Yeah.
Depends on the setting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Tired of talking about.
That's
what was
specific.
It like meeting?
Oh, like it, like sort of fandom.
Yeah,
sort
exactly.
Of thing.
Yeah,
exactly.
Because
yeah.
It was cool.
Crazy shit, dude.
So
we're
narking.
Okay.
You have enough chairs and everything?
Yeah, I think we're all good.
Everything you
need?
Yeah, we're great.
Thank you very much.
See you later.
Yeah, see you. Thanks so much.
And what are your ideas on the relationship between jazz and hip-hop? This is what I want to hear about. What are your ideas on the relationship between those two music genres?
I mean, like, from like, there's so many different levels you can break it down.
I guess start.
But I mean, like, if you really think about it, they're almost the exact same thing. Mm. It's like both like really like soloistic performance practices.
Right.
You know, you have kind of like a rhythmic thing going on in the background, and then someone doing something that's like clearly them on top. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then like even the way that it's like, you know, you have all these jazz recordings like, oh, who took that solo? Who did that? It's like, oh, who's rapping right now? Who's doing that? You know what I mean? But at the same time, it's like, you know, there's also like a sort of
even
like connoisseurship
like,
to it, where it's like, you know, people can really identify like who's rapping even if they don't know the song. You know, it's like, you can easily tell like what a Tupac verse sounds like, what an MF Doom verse sounds like, you know. And it's really, it's like, it's probably their voice, but a lot of it has to do with like what their flow is and stuff. And it goes like hundreds and thousands of rappers like beyond. You can tell
yeah.
what almost every rapper sounds like.
It also
you know?
Goes to like,
which is exactly what you can do with jazz, because you hear a golfy solo, it's like,
you know,
it's Eric Dolphy.
Yeah.
And then behind the soloist is probably some kind of rhythm section that's, you know, pushing boundaries, supporting this artist,
yeah,
like,
so
what
like,
they're doing.
Who made
same
that beat?
Thing.
Who put
yeah,
that
who made
section?
That beat?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Where are they coming from with this like weird abstract style or this sample?
Who
was
that
like,
sample? Yeah.
Like
session bass on a 5-string bass. You know.
Yeah,
five,
exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, there's so many. Actually, I feel like we've never really made this like connection in the interview, but
yeah.
it's like 100% the biggest connection.
Yeah. We're doing all right now, aren't we?
Yeah.
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 Okay. And
there's
the,
also a lot of like cross pollination
yeah.
too, because like. Then producers started sampling jazz records, and then
rappers
started collaborating more recently with jazz artists, and vice versa. And,
so,
you know,
yeah.
For example, Tribal Quest, you know,
yeah.
Ron Theory, Ron Carter,
yeah,
all
yeah.
Space
stuff
Boy.
Like that. Yeah.
Exactly. So this is like the kind of thing that we're trying to sort of fall into, that sort of golden age of hip-hop, that kind of 1990s, early 1990s,
yeah, yeah.
where like jazz was fused with hip-hop, and is the year 1993 actually significant to you? Or?
I mean, like,
I feel like he should go because he's more into with years than us.
Well, I mean, like, maybe like historically and chronologically, yeah, it's significant because a lot of great albums came out at that time.
Right.
You know what I mean? But in terms of like hip hop, it's like, you know, the entire, really all of hip hop is amazing. You know what
yeah.
I mean? Like, it's not just like, you know, a lot of people say it's like the one amazing era where hip hop is incredible, but it's like, you know, like the Kendrick Lamar album that came out last year
he's
was like
coming.
Insane.
He's coming,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
and it's like, that's, in my opinion, just as good, if not better, than a lot of the albums that came out like
exactly.
15 years ago. You know?
Okay.
So,
yeah, it's very boundary pushing, and like, you know, just because like hip hop sounded a certain way at that time, which is amazing, and we love so much of that stuff. It's, you know, I think the coolest thing about hip hop is you can't predict what the fuck it's
yeah,
going to
exactly.
Yeah.
You can't predict that, like, you know, vocal samples pitch down 4 octaves, it's going to make it big on, like, you know,
or like
so
five
like
different
and like
separate hi-hat layers on the same track.
Exactly.
With like, you know,
yeah,
like,
and then just like
30-second
you
know, kick drums like is going to be the next biggest set.
Versace
yeah,
is
yeah,
the
exactly.
biggest
set.
Yeah.
yeah.
You know,
then
you
Drake's going to sing on a Migos verse.
So the like the changeability and the flexibility of music is more, you're more into the fluidness of
yeah,
of
I think
flow,
we
yeah.
just don't
want
to stop
yeah, exactly.
to any of it. You know?
Exactly.
Yeah, like,
I think every year in hip-hop's an amazing year, you know, not just 93.
I totally agree.
Before and after, yeah, exactly.
2006.
So
I think we maybe feel like a little bit more personally connected to 93 if we were like 15 at the time.
Mm.
Yeah, exactly.
I was 2.
Yeah.
He was 3.
I was 3.
You
were
1. He was 1. Exactly. So it's a little different in
yeah.
perspective from it.
You just sort of listen to the vibrations and probably bumping
all,
up and down like toddlers.
Yeah.
Exactly.
My
yeah.
parents
yeah.
were listening to
yeah. that. Someone was definitely
yeah.
bumping
yeah.
like something beyond instead of.
yeah. Everyone had their own influences.
Yeah,
really,
absolutely.
Right?
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
You've been described as imaginative revolutionaries. I'm not going to tell you who told you. You described. Do you like this title, or could there be room
no.
for improvement?
I don't feel like we're revolutionaries.
It's a nice compliment
right
now.
Yeah.
I don't.
Yeah, absolutely not.
We're.
I would say you
come from an age where everyone's a revolutionary.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're humbly taking the compliment, but not.
I think
really.
It's anything about being humble. It's like if anyone actually thinks they're revolutionary or fucking whatever, it's like
yeah.
that person. Yeah.
All right, and just two more questions. What's on your iPod? Can you show me what's on your iPod or
the last track?
The last track.
Actually,
let's just see the last track of his.
No, it's perfect. I was already listening to this earlier today.
It's
and it's like it's 100% really translatable to this show tonight because it's like relaxing. It's also really tasteful.
Celine Dion, ladies and gentlemen. So,
yeah. It's gonna be really quiet, but
so it's J.L.T.
Oh, by CCG.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it's an amazing song.
It's All Work Out in Boomland, which
yeah.
is a great title.
It's actually a band from Canterbury, England. Yeah, in 1973, I think the record came out. And yeah, it's like pretty amazing. Like, it's actually a really rare record. Like, you try to find it.
Yeah.
Not online. It's like $500. And they only ever did one album.
And where did you find your music? Where have you specifically found this? Like, how have you found this?
We found this through a friend who's like a serious record collector.
Right.
He actually goes on the back Yeah, he actually wrote two songs on the last Charles Bradley album.
Could you say his name one more time?
Frank Dukes.
Frank Dukes.
That boy Hill.
Okay, good.
Hey. Hello.
How you doing? Can I leave you a chocolate box?
Oh, of course. Amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Okay, well,
which is for us.
Yeah, it's for you.
Thank you so much.
There you go.
Thank you very much.
Enjoy.
Thank you.
Bye, guys.
All right, awesome. That's actually great. I actually want to have a look at that.
And I know what's the last thing you played?
Yeah.
I was listening to like a Trojan Records like reggae covers of like vintage soul songs.
Cool.
That's the one that was super awesome that we heard.
Well, there's like People Make the World Go Round by the Stylistics, but covered by the Chosen Few, which is like.
Is that on that compilation?
Yeah.
Oh,
and there's a bunch of other.
What was
too.
On that? I was
me,
like
me and Mrs. Jones.
Oh like, yeah, like a jazz like standard fucking.
No, it's like there's two different. Like,
it's not happy.
Sorry. It's a Marvin Gaye. It's like a Marvin Gaye song,
yeah,
but
yeah.
A reggae.
And what's on yours?
This dude Jerry Paper.
Jerry Paper.
Yeah. The song I was listening to was actually not the song that I thought it was. It was at the end of the album.
Okay, so Jerry Paper.
But he's just like
enjoying.
Well, there's like a whole bunch
is
of
shitty.
Crazy, yeah.
This
like,
is
crazy.
Okay. Everything is shitty by Jerry Paper. This is his vocal what, distorted or what?
Yeah.
Very good.
Dude is fucking crazy.
Yeah.
Nice.
Check him out.
Sean fucking Cannon would be really cool.
Yeah,
so you got
a
22-year-old
dude who just does a lot of acid and DMT all the time.
Matt
yeah.
actually just found him on like looking up random
found him on a forum.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we hit him up
fucking crazy.
And we played a show in New York.
He just owns
he
like
came.
A bunch.
And we met him, and
yeah,
he's like the
fucking coolest guy. Yeah, he just like has like rare sins.
Looks really similar to Matt.
He makes like super like.
He's your doppelganger, isn't he?
Yeah, basically. He actually looks exactly like me. It's not me, I swear.
The alter ego going on here.
It's just like really relaxing and tropical. With weird synths that sound terrible, but amazing at the same time.
Wait till the melody comes in. It's amazing.
Yeah, okay. You gotta wait till this like amazing. It's like cheesy, but on purpose almost. Like. I mean, his voice sounds a lot like Brian Eno, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's a Brian Eno kind of style.
The synth stuff just sounds like as if someone made, like, tropical-sounding
yeah.
music with bad synths instead of good sounding.
It's Mr. Paper, okay, Jerry Paper.
Yeah.
And then, last question, what's next for Badbadnotgood?
Working on
putting out
some
a new
album.
Music.
Yeah.
Good.
That's tools. In a couple of months, hopefully.
Okay.
We have a track on Earl's new
fall.
Album. Oh yeah, we confirmed to finally finish the song.
Okay, cool.
For Earl Sweatshirt's album.
Sounds cool.
Nice. Okay, and you have a name for your new album yet?
Not necessarily, but
yeah.
Working title
yeah,
the industry.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right. Thanks very much, boys.
Yeah, thanks so much.
Cheers.
Awesome.